the capital where I'm raised in Reykjavik, it has become very, very big. I go to Iceland and I have no clue where I'm at, unless I go into the old part where I was raised, which was the very, very old part of the capital, and it's very close to downtown. The house I was born in still looks the same. And everything has changed. People have changed. Things are faster, more cars, graffiti. There's many things that have changed in my country. I don't think I've lost them. People tell me I still have an accent.
I mean, when you get...
Oh, when I get there. Oh, it takes me like 4 days to be able to speak my language. I have lost a lot of my language. I sort of speak more like a child right now. I try to read it. I read newspapers on the internet and things like that. But there are some words that don't look like words to me anymore. And I don't know what they mean. So yeah, I've lost my language a lot.
Since my earliest recollection of even doing like elementary school reports, I would always do Asian book reports, or, you know, talk about Asian customs as much as I could. My mom, she brought back a lot of artifacts from when she was there. And so we always had, you know, just different Vietnamese household items, or even Vietnamese some art as well. So it was always really conscious in my mind, but it wasn't until more of my high school and college years that I really connected, I think, my own personal identity and Asian culture identity. We came in through Seoul, Korea, and then took another smaller plane to Hanoi. And, you know, you're in the plane still, and the captain announces, you know, welcome to Hanoi in three different languages. And, you know, even not getting off the plane, you know, I felt so excited. And I did feel like I was at home. I did feel more at home, though, when we took the other plane to come back from Hanoi to Saigon, because that's where my mom, my adopted mother, had lived for 3 years before she adopted me. And I really felt that I was walking, you know, where she was walking almost 34 years ago. And I was able to find her her apartment building. It was a different street name, but I found the building still. And it's close to a large city market, so I was able to walk around the city market where she shopped, you know, almost daily. And you know, I wanted to just kind of like lay down on the street or on the ground and just, you know, give it a hug, give it a kiss, like something. So yeah, that I felt really at home in Saigon.
There is, for me personally, I have been a little cut off from the essentially Bengali, which is what the people of Bangladesh are Bengali as a people. I've been kind of cut off essentially from the Bengali crowd, if you will, living here in Chicago. Primarily for opportunity reasons, I would say. I, you know, come to work and then go home, and then, you know, you're so pooped by the time you get home, you're just, you know, flat out by the time you get home. And then on weekends, you're busy running around doing your own little thing. So there's not a lot of opportunity to join, say, an organization that would consist of a group of your people or your community, and maintain connections that way. So I've not really been able to keep in touch in that regard. The keeping in touch is more at a very personal level, where it's contacting family and friends who are here in the States and also back home. And then very recently, it turns out that over the years that I've been here, a lot of my buddies, my high school buddies and so on, have been trickling in to the United States, and now it turns out that almost all of them are here in different states. So it's almost like, hey, gee, we could have a high school reunion, you know, of the core group. Everybody has a core group, you know, not just the whole entire high school. So we recently actually got together and formed, a web page and a web meeting place. So now we meet on the web regularly. to keep in touch with everybody, and that's how we have been doing it. Well, using basically modern technology, I suppose, to maintain the contact.
My parents, they're actually very connected in the community. My mom, she attends the temple events. Like the Buddhist temple events, like occasionally, like at least once or twice a week. My father, not so much. But my parents call my relatives in Laos more frequently now to just check up on them, to see how things are going. But I definitely think my parents are very connected.
When it's more warmer, I used to go by the lake. I like to be by the water. In Puerto Rico, it was way more easier just because it's an island and it's surrounded by water. But here, I just try to go, you know, have my own time, be alone by the water. Maybe I write poetry too, so that connects me a lot with my country. I kind of communicate with my country by my poetry, so that's basically what I do.
I keep in touch with the Venezuelan community here, with the consulate, and try to be active. I have been involved in helping to organize an event that happens in DeKalb, Illinois, in the Northern Illinois University and the Women's Art Center. And every year we try to create an exhibit of artwork by Venezuelan artists. And they in DeKalb, they named, I think it was May 3rd, being the day for Venezuela, about 7 years ago. So like every year, we try to do something to go along with that day. So that's one of the things that I do. Try to be involved with the Venezuelan consulate, see what's going on culturally, help them to bring people here for cultural events.